I said, how do you write, like, for, I can write more on the heart, but the fact is, but the cardiac cycle, there's only so much to the cardiac cycle that you can describe. Yeah, no, page bharte jaye. Okay, how does that link back to, so in there was this whisper. All, I think all of us growing up, we have a whisper in the heart. Huh? But what's happening is the whisper is trying to tell you something, but we're being drowned out by the noise outside of us. So our inner volume control is on 0, and the outer volume control is on 10, maybe 13. So you're getting parents, society, friends, strangers telling you exactly what you need to do. You know, and I had the same thing. You know, I wasn't a naturally self-confident kid. You know, I was always thinking that other people know better. Older people know better. Huh? But something happened with me. This was that I had a chance to, my father was in the airlines, and he moved, the family moved to New York. And at the age of 13, for 2 years, basically, I had no friends over there. Because it was a huge culture shock. I mean, unlike now that you have Twitter, Facebook, you know, you have the social media, text messaging. Then, back then, if you wrote a letter from Lahore to New York, it would take 3 weeks to reach, you know, and another 3 weeks to respond. So 6 weeks would go by when you finally found out what was happening. Huh? So when I landed in New York, it seemed like I'd landed on a different planet. Because this was the age of rock and roll. You know, there was these bands like Led Zeppelin and the Rolling Stones. And, you know, like my mother, her only comment was, all of these people are amoral. All they do is they grow their hair long and they do drugs and worse things, right? So the family opinion of rock music wasn't very high. When I was in middle school, one day I was getting on my school bus when this kid, another friend, who became a friend, called Danny Spitz, and he came up to me and he looked at me and he said, Sal, he said, dude, you gotta become cool. So I said, cool? What is cool? So he took out this red ticket from his back pocket, right? And he said, if you buy this ticket from me, you shall become cool. So I said, what? He said, this is a ticket for Monday night. It's the only one I have left. And it's to a rock concert at Madison Square Garden. Now, I didn't even know what Madison Square Garden was. He said, it's the place where all the greatest rock concerts take place. I said, now he's 13 years old as well, okay? So, you know, no great experience there. But there was something, you know, like this whisper. The whisper tells you, buy the ticket. Okay, buy the ticket. And now I'm thinking, my mother, you know, conservative Pakistani Muslim woman, I'm going to say to her, I'm going to a rock concert in Madison Square Garden. This ain't going to happen. Okay. But the whisper said, buy the ticket. So I bought the ticket off him. And by the way, Danny Spitz went on to form the heavy metal band Anthrax. It's a guitar player. So we both went to the same school. So I came home and I said to my mother, Monday night, you have to drive me into New York City. So we live like, you know, upstate, which is like 45 minutes up north. And going to the city was like, you know, from Lahore to Islamabad. Okay? That was the city. Okay, what's happening in the city? There's this rock concert. Rock concert? So it's a school project. Okay, what school project? The entire school, which was actually not a lie, because the majority of the school was going to this show. So the entire school is going to see this concert, and you know, you have to drive me. So my mother goes, okay, for Allah's sake, if you do drugs, I'm going to disown you. The biggest fear was drugs. So, and I thought like aspirin was a drug, right? So she, you know, as you know, Pakistani children, when we go out, we're supposed to dress nice. So my mother made me wear a yellow floral shirt, red and white striped pants, black shiny boots, and a black belt, right? And she's driving me to Madison Square Garden. Okay. So as we enter there, now we get close to 7th Avenue and 33rd Street, you know, there is a mass traffic jam. And everywhere, all you see is thousands and thousands of teenagers, right? Torn jeans, peace signs. Now I'm talking about the late 70s, so I'm dating myself, right? Long hair, beads, Sufiana de sare. So I get off, I ask my mother to drop me off like 4 blocks away from Madison Square Garden, right? And I'm walking towards this place, and it was another, it seemed like there was an electric urs happening. You've always been to this urs na, but like devotees, you know, whirling dervishes. Whirling because of not the love of God, but some chemicals, yeah. Right? So anyway, I enter the garden, and there's this mass sort of humanity, and everybody's happy. Everybody's just smiling. Young people, just imagine 21-year-olds, 22-year-olds, 14-year-olds, just in a state of enjoyment, you know, completely different world. Just when Alice went into Wonderland, that's perhaps, you know, how I could draw this comparison. Anyhow, for 1 hour, nothing happened. It was like the Karachi Carlton, all dressed up and no place to go. And so then, about an hour later, the PA system, there's a guy who comes in with this really loud voice, and he says, "Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Led Zeppelin." Now, I don't know if you guys know, but Led Zeppelin is the ultimate heavy metal band. I wouldn't even say heavy metal band. They're the quintessential rock band of all times, right? I had no clue. So I was in the 63rd row alone, right? I only have one ticket. And when this band comes up on stage, the lights go down, these laser lights hit the guitar player, right? And, you know, he had this sort of otherworldly appearance. Jimmy Page was the guitar player. And he had a two-headed guitar, you know, double-necked guitar. Red, gleaming, huh? He had dragons painted on his pants. And it just seemed like, you know, when your passion just kind of sort of materializes, that's what happened to me. And then he played these incredible, like, sounds, okay, on that guitar. The double neck has 12 strings on it. One of the songs he played, everybody got up and started screaming, "Kashmir!" Kashmir? It's dangerous there, right? So anyway, that's one of the Zeppelin's tunes. That night, 3.5 hours later, I was convinced, this is what I want to do for the rest of my life at the age of 14. And then I think, you know, in me, Junoon, the word Junoon means obsessive passion, uncompromising passion, that when you want to do something, then you will do everything and anything to achieve it. I just was like a pit bull after that. I just said, guitar khareedna, and then we're sitting here today.
No, thanks. But I'm just playing devil's advocate. Hamare mulk mein masla ye hota hai ki, as you know, outside, but plus there is this huge fear, even not just here, also in the West, is what if I crash and burn? Okay, I'm taking this leap of faith, Magan. And you, because, and it's easy for you to say you made it, theek hai na? For all the, and you probably passed over the wreckage of thousands of people who didn't make it. So that's the only, you know, comment I'd like to make. That's the only issue. Dar lagta hai to follow your heart. But then, as you say, so rightly in your book, okay, you just go for it, theek hai na? And sorry, yeah.
Oh, no, I have a question. Maybe you could address it to me. And you know, I feel like I can ask this question now because I'm just tired of not talking about these things in Pakistan. Mm-hmm. When I first, I'll be honest, when, you know, I've heard of Junoon for years. I am older than you, but I know Led Zeppelin well. But, and I'd heard of Junoon, but I really didn't know anything about you until I picked up the book. And I thought, what is this rock and roll jihad? And oh, I'm not talking loud enough. And what I found very impressive about the book is not only what you went through in your own life, but the fact that you have a very, very good critique of cultural issues in Pakistan and how,
I've published, I'm one of these international authors. I write lots of books on Pakistan and have written a lot of, my very first book was Islamic Reassertion in Pakistan, The Application of Islamic Laws in a Modern State.
Just let everybody know.
Oh, my name's Anita Weiss. But what I found very impressive in your book was how you critiqued what was taken away from Pakistan during Zia, that started in Zia's time and is still gone. And the thing is, it's, and that's what I said at the very beginning, this is the type of thing we haven't even talked about. People don't talk about it in Pakistan, but I think right now we have to start talking about it. So I was wondering if you could address some of those themes and issues. I really liked how you juxtaposed Qawwalis in the book and the inspiration you got from Qawwalis, but also how so much, I mean, right now to hold a musical show in Lahore, it happens, but everybody who goes to it is a little nervous.
So, great question. I think that's one of the core reasons that I actually wrote the book. The backstory, how many of you have read the book? Okay, so there you go. So why the book? First of all, Rock and Roll Jihad, why the title, right? Because a lot of people thought, you know, Rock and Roll and Jihad, why would you put those two terms together, you know? In fact, my publisher, Simon & Schuster, said that perhaps you could think of another word than Jihad for the book title. And I said, haven't you read the book? And they said, yes, but the fact is that, you know, we're going to have trouble promoting the book, you know, getting you on TV because of this word. And then in Pakistan, people said, perhaps you could change the word rock and roll, right? So both are contaminated words, right? Rock and roll signifies, you know, all the things that I suppose Pakistani society, Pakistani parents are afraid of the West, right? Beta, thoda sa, and jihad, people see jihad as representing Al-Qaeda, Taliban. They don't know what the real core meaning of the word is, right? So I chose to both of these words because I wanted people to, you know, start a debate on what is jihad, what is rock and roll. And my cultural journey is a collision of both cultures, East and West, yeah? When I came back to Pakistan from the States, there was a culture in which everything that was Pakistani, everything that made Pakistan beautiful, arts, literature, music, poetry, dance, seemed like it was a taboo, alien, sort of Uriani, vulgar, obscene. Okay, Ziaul Haq, because he came into power, he was a military dictator, came into power for 11 years, controlled the levers of power, controlled mass media. Again, you students of mass communication, you know how powerful the media can be in shaping minds. So he made, in those 11 years, he made everything that made Pakistan beautiful seem ugly. So everything that was beautiful, he made ugly. Now, why I say everything beautiful? Because in the book, I write about my earliest experience with music, which was Qawwali at a family wedding. You know, I didn't know the history behind Qawwali, but I just knew, my heart knew that this is beautiful. Those rhythms are intoxicating, trance-inducing. And it was a regular part of our daily life, okay? Movies. Well, as a child, I used to go with my aunts and uncles, went to see Waheed Murad, you know, who was like the Elvis of Pakistan, you know. And there was a song called Coco Corina, in which he has a guitar. All of you seen that. It's on YouTube, right? And you know, it was exciting. It was Pakistani. It was indigenous. We were a teenage nation, you know. When I was born, Pakistan was a teenage nation. And there's something quintessentially Pakistani about ke hum apna rasta khud dhoondenge, you know, ke we'll find our own way towards arts and culture, sports, you know. And there was no sense of fear in society. I mean, that's how I remember my youth, was there was no sense of fear in society. Ke, we're a young teenage nation and we're going to make something of ourselves. But in Zia's time, the change was that there was oppressive state control over all kinds of minds, and especially if you were a teenager, you know. My first encounter, you know, with playing a guitar publicly was that it was violently broken, you know. And I was told that if you ever play this guitar, you will be shot, you know. My critique of the Zia years is that there was a mind control which his government and, you know, all the functionaries, whether you wanted to hold a function like a college function to a TV show, they made you feel that this was actually vulgar and obscene. Whatever you're trying to do is vulgar and obscene. It's ugly, it's not part of our culture. And he implanted an alien mutation of Islam, I would say. The Wahhabi understanding of what Islam is, it wasn't even, he just created something of his own. And yet there was a hypocrisy, because his whole family were great fans of Indian films. Shatrughun Sinha, who is a famous Indian actor, used to be a state guest. So on the one hand, he's clamping down on culture in Pakistan, yes, yet it's fine for Indian artists to come and stay at the state guest house. So what kind of signals was he giving out, you know? In a sense that we had to unthinkingly recreate culture. When I was in college, we had to recreate a youth culture for Pakistan, and that started with Dil Pakistan.
So talking of music, let's drift slowly towards the music and your straddling of two cultures, because you had to, you spent so much time there and so much time here. And but in terms of bringing the music together, the structure, as you know, the structure of Eastern music, you know infinitely better than me, is very different with your rags and your, you know, combination of notes within that rag and Western chord structure. And was it easy to merge the two? Was it an effort? Did it come naturally?
You know, when we're 13, 14 years old, when we watch a film, or even younger, right? When we watch a film or listen to a music performance, right? We don't analyze it, dissect it. We listen to it, and either it touches your heart, or you say, "It's something new." I don't understand it. So, with me, when I listen to, let's say, you know, when I was a child, listening to Bollywood songs, or listening to Qawwali, or going to see Led Zeppelin, it connected as one whole, all right? It never was, this is East and that is West, you know? This is Indian, this is Pakistani. It always created a oneness, which for me, I mean, that's been the core anchor in my life, that when I see the world, I don't break it. You know, they say that when you, Einstein said this, that the process with which he discovered the theory of relativity, they asked him that, how did you come up with E is equal to MC squared? And he said music.
We're a young teenage nation, and we're going to make something.
Music. And you know, he played violin as well. Einstein played violin, and he listened to a lot of classical music. So he said that music sparks this creativity. You know the difference between the right brain and the left brain, right? The right brain is your creative, intuitive, has the creative intuitive functions, and the left brain is more logical, rational, right? So he said the process that he worked with was that he allowed the right brain to feel, to absorb. And once he understood these architectures of what became the theory of relativity, then he rationalized, you know, deduced and came to E is equal to MC squared. So as human beings also, when we love someone, okay, well, you know, you may love a parent, or you might love your fiance, or you know, your husband or wife, You don't dissect and analyze why you love them. Because I know from medical school that when you dissect, you eventually end up killing, right? To analyze anything, yeah? So that unknowingly, basically, coming to musical scales, there's 10 basic thards in our classical music, right? You know, Bilawal, Khamaj, Kalyan, Bhairo, Bhairvi. Now, all they are is Sare Gama Pa Dha Ni Sa, Sa Ni Dha Pa Ma Ga Re Sa. And in Western classical music theory, there's 7 basic modes. Right? Ionian, Dorian, Phrygian. These are names, okay? So I can get stuck into the names of them. I can get stuck into the Sare Gama Padha Nisa. But if I took everything away and I just played you these scales, you would say it's the same thing. Okay? So my understanding of music is really not over intellectualization. I think it's important to intellectually understand, but to be stuck in an intellectual box, you lose the spirit of things. All the music that I make, the compositions that I've come up with, are never intellectual. It's whatever. Just now, for example, Jazba Junoon, right? I was stuck in a rut in my life. You know, I thought I'd be this great guitar player, and things were that I couldn't even pay the bills for my family, right? So this melody just came. I was in the car, and a melody just came. Na 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 na. Now, Gari, when I was in the car, when that melody came, it didn't say this is A minor Aeolian. It just came as a melody, and it had a groove to it. It had a movement to it. And then with words on top of it, it sounded really cool. Okay? So to simplify, things have to sound beautiful, exciting, passionate, and then you can dissect as much as you want what it eventually became.
You have a guitar?
I do have a guitar.
Yeah, let's.
Yeah. So in the end, we can do the guitar
stuff. Maybe. Okay. Look, bad things happen in life. Uh-huh. All right. Ziya's era, we know what happened, what we lost. But Ziya is dead since over 2 decades now. Yeah. Right. Yeah. What the hell have we done since then to have reclaimed what we had lost? All right. So I think the blame, in my opinion, lies equally on our so-called elite civil society of the last 2 decades, as much as Ziaul-Haq. And we can then buzdali and selfishness, if we can creep out of it, miracles start happening. And I think I blame the civil society as much as Zia or military or politicians for our current state. I just need to know your opinion. And going forward, I understand Imran Khan phenomena. I see this a manifestation of the civil society movement that's a global movement right now. And so how do you foresee going forward, and how do you what would you recommend, what would you suggest could be the possible solutions going forward?
Thanks, Ameen. Those are very pointed and really important questions. So yes, I certainly am not saying that it's all the fault of Ziaul-Haq. And had Ziaul-Haq not happened, none of this, you know, we would have been living in a progressive, peaceful, democratic state. I feel that there was an apathy, okay, a great apathy amongst civil society in Pakistan over the last 3 decades to abdicate control to the state, you know. Even though we had these dictatorships interspersed with these sort of spurts of pseudo-democracy, right? We never really felt like citizens of a state. We didn't know our rights, you know, women's rights, anybody's rights, you know. Okay, what is truly ours to, you know, as human beings, to fight for and to voice? And so to begin with, I feel that all of that's happened in the last 30 years, and you know, it's bookended with two wars. One, the Soviet-Afghan Jihad, and now the American occupation of Afghanistan, you know, and in which, again, both times, Pakistan has been affected by, you know, Pakistani culture has deeply been affected by both those wars. I can't underemphasize that, you know. But here's the silver lining to this, that in my book, one of the reasons I wrote this was that you could actually see a snapshot of how life was, me as a teenager, growing up in a country affected by another war, right, affected by a military dictatorship, and then in between having these experiments of democracy taking place, what's the silver lining is that I see your generation, especially, right, waking up. There's an awakening taking place. You know, when Imran Khan asked me to come and perform at that Unity Jalsa on the 25th of December, it was amazing to see over 200,000 people, and amongst them, majority of them being young people, okay? And it seemed like a rock concert. Like, when I performed the national anthem on the guitar and Jazba Junoon, there was this energy which you felt at rock concerts or cricket matches. Okay, and it seems like a nation is there, not because they're being forced to go see this jalsa, let's go to this jalsa. They want to be part of something big. They want to be part of a change, you know. And perhaps, I mean, you know, the change that we've seen in Egypt, in Tunisia, that all of this is a part of a global youth change, transformation that's taking place. But I always believe that Pakistan has been ahead of the curve, that in terms of anticipating change. I mean, for example, the lawyers movement in 2007, you know, it was a revolutionary civil society change. I mean, it was a civil rights movement, the lawyers movement. But then with everything gets morphed and mutated, right? So right now, what do I think Pakistan needs? Pakistan needs a civil society movement. Okay, change. I've come up with three words: Aman, Rozi, Talim. And if you look at the acronym A, R, and T, ART, you know, Aman, Rozi, Talim, that no matter which side of the divide, you may be on a, you know, conservative, liberal, right, left, centrist, wherever you are, you can agree on peace, right? You can agree on jobs, you know, job security, financial security, and yes, we can all agree on talim, right, education. So peace, jobs, and education. I believe if we fight for these rights, this generation, you know, some of you are from Karachi University, mass communication, and you're going to become journalists, right? From 20 to 30, let's say 2012 to 2022, I feel is the most crucial decade in the history of this nation thus far. We can take Pakistan, and people think I'm crazy, but I think in 2022, Pakistan can be a first world nation. Inshallah. Ismail?
Hi, I just got two questions for you. Answer as you would like. One is reinvention. You seem to be fantastic at reinventing yourself, if that's the proper term, from guitarist to singer, and writing a book. There's a lot of good work that you've done in America as well. Your views on reinvention, how you do it, and what is next? That's one of the questions. The other question is, being associated with radio, your last album I thought was amazing. And with the words, the rhythm, and your voice. Great fan of that. When are you coming out with another one? Okay, here we go.
Thanks, Sohail. Well, I hope you're not talking about reinvention the way Madonna looks at reinvention. So. no, I just try to be in the now. Okay, so I guess that when people say, gee, okay, you know, you were with the Vital Signs and you were with Junoon and now, you know, you're writing a book. And I don't see my life in terms of, you know, these blocks and chunks. Okay, you know, people see me as a Junooni or they see me as basically a guitar player. Or if you're following your passion, apna Junoon jab usko pursue karte hain, point is, your passion isn't static. It's never going to remain stuck in one era or one box or, you know, one. I think all of us are multidimensional beings, right? Whether we choose to acknowledge that or not, we are multidimensional, you know. Especially the ladies have an incredible knack of multitasking as well. It's incredible. My wife, the way she's able to jump from singing to cooking to managing me, right? Which is the toughest job on earth, right? But the fact is that we are multidimensional. And so when you say reinvent, I'm not reinventing, right? I'm just discovering all that there is, trying to discover what moves me inside. And these days, obviously, you know, music has always been a core foundation of who I am. These days I'm doing a movie, my first Bollywood movie. It's called Rhythm. I'm appearing in it. I'm doing the music to it as well. Also, I'm looking to do a TV program in Pakistan because I feel really excited. Yeah, you know, this thing that I'm saying, that these 10 years in Pakistan, 2012 to 2022, I need to put the greatest focus here. And do things through music, through TV, maybe a little bit of writing as well. Although I have to say the toughest thing I ever did was write a book. I don't know how you managed to. How many books have you done? 5. It takes your life out of you to write a book. 3 books. Wow. You know, so it takes a tremendous amount of focus to write a book. But I had an amazing team of people, you know, Simon Schuster, and I'm really happy that Oxford University Press has chosen to, you know, launch it here. Thank you. The next album. Okay, so I keep writing songs all the time, right? This Bollywood project, as I was working on an album project with Peter Gabriel, right? Peter, I did a song with Peter Gabriel, who's, you know, one of my most loved artists. You know, he discovered Nusrat Fateh Ali Khan. So we had an opportunity to collaborate on a song, Open Your Eyes, which is, by the way, on the it's the first song on Junoon's 20th anniversary. But in between that came this Bollywood project, which is sort of really big, you know. So I'm focusing on the Bollywood thing, and then I'm going to get back to that album afterwards.
I want to just say, like Anita said, a wonderful book. And this has been one of my favorite gifts that I give to people. And the first one I got, Fauzia Saeed, my name. सोशल एक्टिविस्ट हूँ. जो आपसे पहले जो आपका सवाल था, मैं थोड़ा सा उसके ऊपर टच करना चाहती हूँ, बिकॉज आई थॉट दैट वाज अ वेरी गुड क्वेश्चन, बट सलमान शुड बी आस्किंग दैट क्वेश्चन ऑफ अस. क्योंकि जो आपने किया, आपने अपना हक पूरा अदा कर दिया, एंड आई थिंक दैट वी आर वेरी प्राउड ऑफ यू. हम पीछे रह गए उसको फॉलो करने के लिए, बिकॉज हम कहते हैं रोल मॉडल्स चाहिए, म्यूजिक पीछे रह गया, और ये तो वी डू हैव रोल मॉडल्स. और जब आपने पूछा कि किताब किसने पढ़ी, तो आई वॉज एक्सपेक्टिंग ऑल दीज पीपल वुड रेज देयर हैंड. सो आई थिंक एज एन एक्टिविस्ट ओवर 3 डेकेड्स, आई वॉन्ट टू शेयर वन थिंग विद द यंग पीपल, एंड जस्ट बिकॉज यू आर सिटिंग हियर. व्हेन जियाउल हक वॉज हियर, एंड यू ऑल वुड नॉट नो हिम, वी थॉट कि इट वॉज अ बैड टाइम एंड इट विल पास एंड वी विल स्टार्ट फ्रॉम वेयर वी वर, एंड इट नेवर डिड. So the point is that we were not at the time of his death, we were not standing where we were in 78. We had lost a generation. We had lost a generation which was in the early teens. And so what we have, we still have at our hands, and I think I belong to the Prezia generation, we are still grappling with. So it's not just the government policy, and it's not just Ziaul Haq, but we do not know what to do with that legacy that has been left. And we can argue with the government and we can argue with the policies, but what we have at hand is a lot of young people who got mutated somehow, and we just cannot let go of that. I won't call that militancy, but a strange ideology that has totally engulfed us. So people like you, I salute, because you have really shown the path, but we are waiting for others to use these role models and use these icons and actually really, it's not just a romance to, I mean, I came on time for this session because I thought I wouldn't have room to get in. You know, that's exact. I left my breakfast and I rushed because I thought this room would be so jam-packed that I wouldn't have a place to sit or stand. So I think that we have not done our work. You have done yours. We need to follow, and we need to. I really want everybody in this room to buy this book, read this book, promote this book among your peers, and you know, have them. Abhi 3rd of March is coming, which is the World Music Day. In Pakistan, nobody would know. You know, these media channels that are blasting, they wouldn't even know. They know every other controversial thing. But we need to propagate this. We need to reclaim this. I think people like him are very brave, who show us the path. And then you talked about Imran Khan also. And you very well said that in the beginning, everybody jumps on to that, you know, path, thinking that we will get to the end that we want to, and then it gets hijacked and it gets, you know, we need to be clear as to what we want to reclaim. And I really want the young people to follow brave people like Salman and listen to him carefully and read what he writes and listen to his music. Thanks.
I was saying a cultural renaissance. I mean, like you said, Zia died a long time ago, but people just haven't taken that step forward. We have little artists here and little artists there, but this cultural renaissance, yes, which will of course have social and political underpinnings.
So,
can I
make a point?
Yeah, please. Ameed wants to make a point.
I think on this cultural renaissance, if you just take a view of our arts and culture, if you see why Rahat Fateh Ali is so popular, is because he had Bollywood songs, and suddenly he has filled jam-packed concerts. He surpassed, or Atif Aslam for that matter, or Ali Zafar. Koi isko lift nahi karata tha about 2 saal pehle. Suddenly Bollywood, and suddenly, you know, he's become a rock star in Pakistan. Or for that matter, our foreign minister, she went over there, got glorified. Suddenly we started seeing her in a different light.
Yeah.
We are kind of stuck up here. And you know, while we say we are cultural here, but I think we've just shifted to the Bollywood. Look at the vulgarity and the violence that you see in that. And it's so popular, everyone is watching these Bollywood movies. My cultural shock came when the Jinnah project with Akbar Ahmed, which I was, and we thought it's going to be a hit, the movie itself. It was a total flop here. Nobody wanted to see, you know, Jinnah and everything. And I thought it would do really well because we'd gone through, you know, I was involved in it, and I thought it was a good movie on its own. So I think, and to be honest, even you, I think, you know, there was that rock and roll era and the thing. Now, even now that you've come here, I feel that, you know, you're absolutely right, Fauzia. This should have been filled. It's not. You know, so we've become like a niche player in a small corner, while the ocean is, be it Bollywood, arts and culture, or even our dramas, if you see, we have such great depths and everything. They're not doing as Saaswai, Bahu, or some nonsense plays. I mean, those are, you know, governing our airways. So I think we have a psyche change on superficial things. That has taken place, and we need to reclaim that. I understand there is a lot going on, but a lot more needs to be done.
Can I make one or two comments on the question that came before, because that's very close to my heart? That's about 2 decades have passed since Zia, and we have not yet returned to Zia era. And the lady said the same thing. You see, the problem is that you said the same thing. The problem is that somebody like Zia, who's ruled 11 years, leaves a very deep imprint on the society. He changed the mindset. The younger people got involved in very funny ideology, interpretation of Islam, which was not Islam. And then the violence. Don't forget that somebody like Salman Taseer was killed simply because he was going to visit that woman who was being charged for blasphemy while she had not committed any blasphemy. So, yes, it's right to be impatient about these things, but I think we need to take over and reclaim these things, but at the same time, we have to understand realistically what's going on. Why aren't so few people here, you said? It's because people are really scared. Even today, people are scared to go out and speak and talk because they don't know who is going to shoot them, when, for what, and obviously some very stupid thing. Thank you very much.
So, I just wanted to respond. Okay, great input. It sparked thought. Now, let me just ask you, people. How long is our session supposed to be? Huh? We have 15 more minutes. All right. This will be my closing remarks. Yeah. If anybody has a question, short question, you can ask me. I'm happy. This is the reason. I'm going to do a concert tonight, so you'll be able to listen to the music tonight. But I wanted to focus on the book, you know, because people sort of say ki ji gana sunaye aur aage chale. Theek hai na? ज़्यादातर यही है कि गाना सुनाएं और आगे चलें. But all four of you have touched upon themes which are very close to my heart. The simple thing, and come back to the beginning when I was talking to these girls from Karachi University who are in mass communication, you know, who are going to be journalists. You'll be shaping. You see, you have a great power. The potential for a great power in Pakistan. The media is becoming a very influential force. Right? It's a free media. When we were growing up, when we were teenagers, there was no free media. Right? Basically, it was one PTV Khabarnama which said everything's fine in the nation. Right? and Pakistan's doing well. And so we used to go to sleep after that. Right? So questions are being asked in society. Yes, Ameen, I agree with you that Bollywood has the soft power of India. Has a huge imprint, not only just in Pakistan, but in the world over. It's their media looks at Bollywood as a window into their country, right? So they take pride into everything that's Bollywood. Although Shah Rukh Khan, who's also my age, Salman Khan, my age, Amir Khan, they've been there for the last two decades, yet they understand the power of these celebrities and they provide a platform for them to do everything that they've been doing, one. On the other hand, the media here, for some reason or the other, has not been unified in a Pakistani identity, okay? And we can go into a long conversation on what is Pakistani identity, but just like the rest of the country, the media also is not sure what truly is Pakistani, and you know, where should we focus our attention, right? Should it just be politics? Is current affairs, I think one of you girls here said that, okay, actually the focus is current affairs and then arts and culture or entertainment comes. And so what I would say is, moving forward from here, I'm giving you solutions now. Yes, we've had this great deal of confusion since 1947, but it's good to be in confusion because out of confusion comes creativity. Out of confusion comes identity. Moving forward, this is what I would say, that look around you what's happening in the country right now. Amazing things are happening, right? Shoaib Mansoor, a great dear friend of mine, made two movies, Khuda Ke Liye, and this Bol, right? You know, that's not the kind of cinema you'll ever see Bollywood make. Okay? Bollywood would never sort of, you know, masses, thousands of people wouldn't flock to see Bol and Khuda Ke Liye, but in Pakistan they did. Both are super hit films. What does that tell you? That he is capturing the pulse of the nation. He's talking about issues which are, you know, which matter most to Pakistan. So I would want the Pakistani media, I mean, that's what the role of the media is, that what's happening in your own environment. You know, I think Shoaib Mansoor is grossly underestimated in what he's done. Now, my friend Ameed Riaz, his son Usman Riaz, for example, is a 20-year-old arranger, composer, guitar player, multi-instrumentalist. And I saw his video, not through the Pakistani media, right? It wasn't the Pakistani media saying that we have a young, talented guitar player. It was YouTube, right? I saw a video on, somebody tweeted me his video, Firefly, which you all should go out and check out as well. And I was like, wow, you know? And here we are bemoaning that Pakistan mein culture nahi hai, ye nahi hai. Look at these young kids growing up. Bilal Khan is another one, and Zeb and Hania, and there's so many, Coke Studio, for example, right? I'm just telling you, you know, small sort of, these are glimpses, snapshots of Pakistan in these very difficult times. We would say, you know, there's a war going on, yet in this war, these flowers are blooming everywhere. Film, music, books, so many, Mohsin Hamid, Hanif, the fashion. Now, what you need to do is recognize, this is what the media is supposed to do, is to recognize that there's an indigenous cultural movement, renaissance taking place. I would say it's a cultural renaissance taking place. That all of this music that you see, like Coke Studio, you don't hear that in Bollywood. Why? Ameen just mentioned all these artists who've made it big there. Well, you know why? Because they're smart in India. They realize that the talent lies here in Pakistan, so why don't we just bring them there? They just made a movie called Rockstar, okay? Now, my film producer said that they copied the entire look, jo film hai na, they copied based on me and Junoon. Right? So now, if Bollywood, who are great marketeers, you know, if one had to understand marketing from India, Bollywood is the end all and be all of that. If they recognize that Pakistan has this great talent, well, it'd be stupid for us not to reclaim our own talent, you know? So these times that we are living in, I would say, especially young 14-year-olds, 20-year-olds, be proud of being Pakistani, okay? We have a unique DNA, which borders on the Junoon, but you know, that's good as well, right? But our DNA makes us original. And originality is the only thing that people remember. Well, even Ghalib's time, nobody could understand ki uski shayari kya kya rehte. Sher uthana mushkil ho jata tha, huh? But 200 years later, 200 years plus later, we know what a huge literary force Ghalib was. So we are living these times where we have these literary forces, poets, writers, filmmakers coming up, but we need to embrace them. We shouldn't wait for them to be accepted in Bollywood and then say, ah, yaar, ye to ab Raat Fateh Ali Khan ban gaya. No. You know, Nusrat Fateh Ali told me this, I write about Nusrat Fateh Ali Khan, who was one of my biggest influences. You know, he actually made me realize that what a huge, rich musical culture Pakistan has, you know. So first time he asked me to perform, we were doing a fundraiser for Imran Khan's hospital. So I was nervous, you know. I walked up to this, you know, giant of a man, and I said, "Ji, ki kya chahte main kya play karun?" So he said to me in Punjabi, he said, "Jera dil chanda karo," which was the best career advice. Basically, he said to follow your heart. You know, what do you like doing? You know, he could have easily said to me that tum do din juma juma 8 din tumhe hue nahi hai aur tum guitar player karna aa gaye, you know. No, he was he was extremely humble, tolerant also, and he was open to the world. When I asked him about collaborating with Peter Gabriel and Eddie Vedder, you know, these are sort of sort of ones from Pearl Jam, right, a Seattle grunge band. I said, how do you mix Qawwali with Seattle grunge? And he gave me a theological, evidence on that. He said, look, the Quran says, there's a line in the Quran which says, we were made into nations and tribes, right? We created from a mother and a father, made into nations and tribes, so they we may get to know one another. And he says the best way to get to know one another is through music and poetry. And he said, so why not mix Qawwali with the rock and roll? Why not mix Qawwali? So he totally changed the way I looked at music, you know. And so Junoon's, when people heard Sayoni, for example, or this Sufi rock, which people started saying was Sufi rock, it was just being influenced by other Pakistanis, you know. So in the end, I realized that everybody's shown up about a couple hours late. But thank you all for coming. Okay. So isko plug in kar sakte hain? Guitar, wo amplifier kidhar hai? Oh, wahan rakha hua. Okay, so listen, I would much rather, and I think, yeah, we're going to do a concert tonight at 7 o'clock, 7:30, right, 7:30, and I'm really, that tonight's concert has one of my favorite young stars, Pakistani stars, Usman Riaz, who's going to be with me, two classical virtuosos, Intizar Hussain, amazing classical singer, and Ghulam Ali, you'll see that the talent we have in Pakistan, you know, it's incredible, it's just big. So Ameed, thank you so much.
Thank you for your time, thank you for coming here, thank you everyone for turning up, participating, for your wonderful questions. Take care, bye-bye.